Hello, everyone, and welcome to another episode of the Business Growth Show, where we talk about all components of business and how to utilize them for exponential growth. My name is Ethan Cassiotis. I'm a serial entrepreneur, international speaker, results strategist, business coach, mentor, and consultant. After over 14 years of being in business and running multiple companies, I felt called to start this show. I see many people struggling to start or grow a business, which is why I want to help entrepreneurs achieve success in business quicker, more effectively, and sustainably. Today, I have an awesome guest. He is an entrepreneur and a business acquisitions coach where he helps people to buy a business without risking their own money. Welcome, Sebastian Amieva, and thank you for being on my show.
Well, Adin, thank you very much. I feel very honored to stay in your podcast. I think you're doing very great starting this podcast, helping the entrepreneurs community. So I feel very honored to stay with you, and thank you very much for the invitation and for the introduction.
Yeah, lovely. No worries. Thank you, Sebastian, for that as well. And yeah, it's great to have you here. And yeah, you're a very successful entrepreneur. So for those people who don't know who you are, please introduce yourself by telling us your life story.
Yeah, so let's start for where I'm from. So I'm originally from Patagonia, from Argentina. This is in the south on the country. And then I moved to the UK, to London, 6 years ago to secure my capital and to start my own firm. So from the UK, I've been acquiring businesses in Europe, Latin America, and the US. For the last 10 years, I've been doing business acquisitions. And for the last 3 years, I'm mentoring on this topic, business acquisition, because I've been approached by several entrepreneurs via LinkedIn or Facebook. They want to learn how to buy businesses. They are wondering if it's possible to buy businesses without using their own money and all the different ways. So I got a couple of requests about being, you know, they asked me about mentoring and coaching. I said, why not? So 3 years ago, I started with this coaching lifestyle. And also I get to know so many entrepreneurs from different countries, mainly from Canada, Australia, New Zealand, you know, the UK and the US. So it's a global community around business acquisition, merchant acquisition. And also, you know, if you're a coach or if you're a mentor, you cannot push yourself to learn every day new techniques. So you keep updated, you know? So yeah, it's a great journey. It's a great journey, yeah.
Yeah, definitely.
This is a bit of myself, my background.
Yeah, definitely. No, thanks for that. And I agree that, you know, that's a great journey to have. And yeah, the global community, it's amazing when you tap into that. And yeah, I completely agree with, you know, coaching and mentoring is everything, because you need people that are further down the line than you, from that have the knowledge, you know, that you don't have, that have achieved the things, so that you can really get there quicker and keep upgrading, you know, yourself. So they're really great points. You know, it's awesome.
I know,
so
it's amazing. Yeah, it's amazing.
Yeah, no, I love it. So you know, you were saying that you know, I hear people say that we can buy a business without using our own money. So is it possible to do this?
Yes. Yeah, so for me, preparation is key. You know, so many people they got the idea of buying a business without using your money, so they get excited about that idea, that concept, but they're not prepared themselves for the opportunity. So they start for the last step. They start from the deal hunting. They start to seeking for opportunity. But for me, you need to go back, sit yourself, and think, okay, I need to prepare myself for the business opportunity. I need to set up an SPV, which is a special vehicle, you know, and then you need to set up a website, corporate email. You need to have all the documents, the deal maker documents in place, like NDA, letter of intent, share purchase agreement. You need to have your deal team in place, like your accountant, your M&A lawyer, also some investment banker, or somebody who understands the industry that you're buying. Let's say you are buying a manufacturing company and you don't have the experience, you can bring to your board somebody, some non-executive director who fully understand the industry you're buying. So that gives you credibility on the negotiation table. When you sit with the seller or with the broker and you sound knowledgeable in the industry that you're buying, you increase the probability to cross the deal. So for me, being prepared and study negotiation is very important for business acquisition. So this is how you can do it. You have different ways to buy a business without risking your money. For me, the most important one is to build your network with the lenders, because as you don't have the money for the down payment, you need to have your lender's network ready to go. So which kind of lenders? These lenders are called asset-based lenders, because what we are doing is we're using the company target asset as a collateral for the down payment. So having in place the lenders, the asset-based lender plus seller finance, is a way that you can take over a business without using your own money. Of course, you have several LBO strategies, leverage buyer strategies, but this one is the easiest one to start. It's a mix of lenders' money for the down payment, normally is 40 to 60% as a down payment, and the rest you do a deferred payment in a balloon of 5 years. This is called seller finance. So a mix of lenders and seller finance, you can buy a business without using your own money. But yeah, of course, you need to have so many things in place. Like, you need to look like an investor, having your website, having a pitch deck, having a board, so many points that people is sometimes missing. So, you know, increase the probability to succeed if you have all this point in place, right?
Yeah, no, that's awesome. A lot of great value there. And yeah, I completely agree with like having that presence and that professionalism with what you show. Like, you know, a lot of people out there, they don't really, like, they might like whip up a quick landing page. They don't even, you know, they sometimes don't have corporate emails, and that, you know, it doesn't look professional, right? And then when you go into big meetings and you're getting to lenders or you're getting with big businesses, people look at that. They look at the way you dress, you know, they look at how, yeah, you know, your right online presence and all those things to see, you know, does this person seem professional? So, you know, being really diligent in setting that all that stuff up to begin with, so that when you go out to the market, you look professional, is so important, because you could be really professional, be really awesome, but if it doesn't seem like that, that can really hurt your chances of doing things. So yeah, they're really
definitely the online presence, also optimizing your LinkedIn on this business acquisition field. People is checking all the time, you know, a LinkedIn, mainly not Facebook, but mainly LinkedIn. So if you have a solid LinkedIn, also is very, very relevant on this topic. And now another thing that I realize is when you're starting a business acquisition and you said you look like an investor, you optimize your LinkedIn, you have the website, the problem that the entrepreneurs are facing are with the brokers. When you go through brokers, they're normally gonna ask you for proof of funds. So then the story is gonna end, because you don't have funds to show. You can show the income statement. So what you normally need to do with brokers are signing an introduction fee agreement, it's called. That's saying that if the lender is the broker is introducing you a deal, you're gonna pay a referral fee. So that way they are not gonna bother you asking you for proof of funds, because brokers are there to get the commission, and also they are there to filter in the investor or the buyers. So introduction fee agreement is the way to avoid and to make friends with the brokers.
Yeah, definitely. That's awesome, because yeah, I think getting those deals together, especially at the start, you need like, you know, like a broker like that. So that's a really great point on getting agreements, and that's business in general. You know, a lot of people sort of say things and we've got a deal, but if you don't have things in writing, then you can have issues down the line. So that's a great, value there that you provided. So thanks for that. So, you know, I guess you were talking about the different things that you can do with it. So what are the essential steps to buying a business without using your own money?
Yes, yeah, so the steps are, for me, I developed the 8 steps. 8 steps are gonna be, first of all, you need to have an SPV. What is an SPV? It's a legal entity, it's a special purpose vehicle. So you must have an SPV ready to go to use it as a legal entity to take over another company. You need to have a corporate email, a pitch deck, and a website. You need to look like an investment group. And then the most important part is defining your investment criteria. Most people, they don't know what they're looking for. So for me, it's very important to define your investment criteria. What you're looking for, you know? And you need to know what you're looking for, and everybody around you must know what you're looking for. So defining your investment criteria is very important. And you need to put the industry that you're buying, let's say manufacturing, healthcare, transportation, and also the asking price. 1 to 10 million, I advise entrepreneurs to buy businesses between 1 to 10 million, because if it's bigger than 10 million, you have so much competition with the private equity guys, a big family office. So under 10 million, you need to start buying businesses. And then the location, where do you want to buy business? Normally you need to say you want to buy in Australia, UK, US, Canada, you need to define. So these 3 points for the investment criteria. And then you need to look like a boutique. you're kind of a small bank. You need to have all the legal documents like NDA, letter of intent, introduction fee agreement, all the preparation checklist. So all the documents in place. And then we have the part of the deal team. The deal team is very important, having your M&A lawyer, your accountant, and your consultant or technical person. Let's say you don't understand the industry that you're buying, you can bring an expert or technical person. So, and then you have the part of financing your deal, which is developing your lenders network, your asset-based lender network, invoice lenders, this kind of alternative finance markets. Because if you go to a bank normally, they never gonna lend you money to buy a business. They're gonna ask you for personal guarantee, your credit score, and so many questions. So it's better to go to the alternative finance market like asset-based lender. So before going there to buy a business, you should have at least three lenders that you feel comfortable dealing with, and then you can move on to the next step, which is developing your network with family office and private equity firms, matching your investment criteria. No anyone. They must match the investment criteria. So let's say the three lenders you have, you cannot use for the business acquisition. You contact the family office and private equity firm, matching your investment criteria. And after that, after you develop your network, after you have the SPV, your website, the corporate email, you can start with the deal hunting. The deal hunting is the most exciting part, you know, where you go meet the seller, do the viewing of the factory, you meet the brokers, and you're trying to negotiate the price. This is the most exciting part. But the big mistake entrepreneurs are doing are they start from the point eight, which is the deal hunting. So they are missing so many points. And when they are in the negotiation table, they don't have a deal team, they don't have the lenders, they don't have a website, they don't have credibility, they don't know the market they are buying, so they're gonna lose, you know. So it's better to be prepared, fully prepared for the acquisition. And the last point is actually managing your deal. So once you take over a business, you know, you need to manage in your deal or delegate the management. What that advice to my global mentees is to, after the deal acquisition, after you close the deal, you sign the share purchase agreement, it's good to delegate the management to some capable CEO or to keep the current CEO. And then you set up a dividend plan for yourself and you just take money out of the company as a consultant fee or dividend plan. So, and then you have more time. You are a private investor, you delegate the management and you can move on to the next deal. You keep adding companies to your portfolio. So that way, with these eight steps, I believe people can increase the probability to close deal. But you know, people must follow this step. If you're missing one of them, you cannot buy a business if you don't have the money for the down payment. So this eight step I develop is easy to understand. I make it simple, first of all, because English is not my first language. So I try to make everything very simple, you know. So if my grandma understand my system, everybody's gonna understand my system. So
I love it. Don't worry.
And it's working. You know, I'm closing deals with my mentees. For example, one of my mentees closed a deal in transportation company, 1.2 million in Sacramento, California. Another one closed a deal just last week, a commercial lending industry company for 2 million in Canada. So the system is really working. And what I realized as a business coach is, when I get involved with the mentees, they get more results. If I sell to them like an info product, you know, a course, online course, it's a bit too cold for me. I like to get involved with weekly calls, with analyzing the deal together. So that way they feel more supported. As you can imagine, this deal-making journey is very lonely. And I understand what it's like trying to close a deal. So it's better to fully support the people that you're working with weekly calls, even WhatsApp, email, chats. You know, you need to be connected and acting as a real partner, as a real mentor, giving really help. You know, and it's not just a client. I take people like a partnership. You know, it's like a partnership.
Yeah, definitely. That's awesome. And I love that you've simplified it. And don't worry, you've got very good English, even though it's not your first language. So you don't have to worry about that. But I love that you've simplified it, because I think these days, a lot of people, you know, they it's like they don't know what to do, right? So I think the simpler it is, the easier it is for people to get into it. But like you said, you know, you can give people the process, but you know, that that will help them. But then once they get into the deal, or, you know, who they speak to and stuff, it's always different. It depends on the industry. It depends on the type of business, the cost. There's a lot of, you know, different factors when it comes to business, so many different factors. So you need somebody, you know, like yourself, who has the experience and that to be able to say, you know, that I go, listen, I'm at step one or two. I go, listen, what should I do here? You know, and that, and then you can, like, you know, those little WhatsApp messages or on the weekly coaching calls, you know, you can provide that thing so that, you know, they can feel like,
keep accountable, you know, to keep yeah. them accountable. Yeah.
Yeah. They got the confidence, you know, to make that happen along the way. Cause I think that's, yeah, like you said, it's for something like this, you can't just get an online course and just expect that you're just going to be an amazing at buying and selling businesses. Cause there's
Correct.
Yeah, so many things. So yeah, that's really awesome. So in terms of, like, what are some of the opportunities on why we should look into buying a business?
So for me, the best business to buy, is the one who have asset heavy, because as you are not using your own money to buy a deal, you need the lender's money, the asset-based lender money. And normally their main requirements are that the company have at least 5 years on the market, like established business, established brand, like 5 years, plus 5 years on the market. And also asset heavy, like the company must own a real estate, must own a, you know, heavy equipment, expensive machinery, you know, so that makes the deal more easy to close. If it's a service company, it's very difficult because you don't have assets. The only asset you have with the service company, like a marketing or digital marketing, is the contract you have with your clients. So for me, good industries to buy right now are companies like transportation, because trucking companies, because you have the trucks, you have the office, and it's easy to manage the business, the drivers, the trucks, and, you know, and the contracts. Very simple, and I'm getting a lot of results. We are closing a lot of transportation companies. I think this is a good industry to start, and also manufacturing, and right now, healthcare. And in terms of financial ratios, for me, it's important that the company have 3x EBITDA, 4x EBITDA. That means, you know, you can recover the money in 3 years' time. But one thing that is also very important I want to tell you today is you need to have a strategy before you buy a business. People sometimes they are desperate to close a deal. They don't think about how I'm going to perform better, how I'm going to increase the sales of this company. Because remember, you buying a business is in debt, you know, so you need to pay that debt, you know, over the next three to five years. So To make it profitable during that time, you should think about how to increase the sales, how to do a merger or a consolidation model, how to, you know, group more companies, or how to, you know, increase sales minimum. So having a strategy before you actually buying is important.
Yeah, so. Definitely. I love that. And yeah, I think your initial point on the financial stuff with EBITDA, you know, for the people that don't know, that's earnings before interest and tax, depreciation, amortization. So, you know, 3 or 4 times, so you make it over, you said over the next few years. So that's really important to know your numbers. And yeah, strategy, any business, whether it's buying, selling businesses or any business, is extremely important, because you need to know, you know, what it is, and you know, how you can, like you said, leverage. If you're going to buy potentially multiple businesses, can you use you know, your own knowledge or assets that you have in other businesses that you own to bring in and come and build that? You know, can you get in a particular advisor or somebody that you know that has experience in helping to build that business? Because like you said, you need to pay the money back, but also you want to get a good return on your investment. You want to be able to give yourself a good dividend, if that's what it is, you know, from that business, you know, or maybe there's a particular person that, you know, is in the industry that you can bring in and make the CEO, you know, or someone in there that can really drive that. So yeah, they're really awesome points for everyone to know. So thanks for that. And
you're welcome.
So you touched on it a bit before, but so which experts and advisors do we need, you know, to ensure that we complete all of our, like, due diligence for, you know, for reduced risk in this process?
Yeah, so you need three persons for the preliminary due diligence and for the due diligence. You need the accountants for the accounting due diligence, and you need the M&A lawyer, not any lawyer, not a general lawyer. It's better to get a M&A lawyer, merchant acquisition lawyer, who understand about business transactions. So an M&A lawyer for the legal due diligence, an accountant for the accounting legal accounting due diligence, and also a technical person. Because let's say you buy a trucking company, it's good to have a transportation expert or a trucking expert who can check the trucks, who can check the business, so they can give you a professional report. So these three people are very important to have in your deal team for the preliminary due diligence and for the due diligence by itself.
Yeah, that's awesome. And I like how you're saying to be very specific, because, you know, there's a lot of, you know, different types of, you know, lawyers, like in, you know, mergers, acquisitions is something very, you know, specific there. And like the experts, like you said, because, you know, even with accountants, sometimes you want to have people that understand these types of deals, because everyone's got a different experience. So you want to understand who you're getting into can has that experience, and they can, you know, really deliver and advise you accordingly. So that's thanks for that. And so obviously being creative in structuring these deals is important. It's a bit different than, you know, like a standard deal. So what are some of the ways to structure these deals?
The way you structure this deal, so one way that I recommend to start with, you know, your criteria is 1 to 10 million businesses, you know, because if not, you have competition with the family office or private equity firm. So the easiest structure to set up on the letter of intent, when you sign in a letter of intent with the seller, what I do is I put 30% to 60% as a down payment. You know, that money is gonna come from the asset-based lender. So let's say the lender says, Sebastian, for this deal, I can give you 40% of the asking price. So what I'm gonna do is, I know the lender is gonna give me 40%. I'm gonna write down in the letter of intent, I offering you, Mr. Seller, 40% of the asking price as a down payment, and the rest, the 60%, is gonna be a seller finance deal. I'm gonna pay you the rest in the next 3 years. Let's say 300K per year, an example. So that way you structure very simple. It's a mix of asset-based lender for the down payments, and the rest is deferred payments. It's called seller finance. So the seller is agreed to sell you that business that way. At the end of the day, that is what you're doing, is you helping business owners exit, because they maybe are great at building a business. They are great at marketing and getting new contracts, but they don't know how to exit. So they build an empire or a $10 million company, and they don't know how to exit. So you are the solution for these kind of sellers that they don't know how to exit. And you need to build a roadmap. And you always need to offer safety. You know, let's say they're saying, but you give me only 40% as a down payment. How are you gonna know that you're not gonna go bankrupt? You know, you're gonna wanna destroy or empty my company. So you need to offer safety to the deal, and also they can retain shares. You know, let's say if you give 40% as a down payment, they can give you 40% in shares. So they feel safe that way, because if they give you 100% shares when you put only 40% as a down payment, you know, it's a complicated, risky situation for them. So yeah, always offering safety, and be very clear with the how you communicate with the seller, because you need to say that you're buying seller finance only, and you're gonna using your lender's network money, you know, because it's cheaper than using your own money. You got the money to buy the business, but you're using your lender's network because it's cheaper, you know, to close a deal. Why you wanna use your own money if you can use the cheap capital from your lenders, you know, right?
Yeah, definitely. Now that's really great. Excuse me. And I like the combination of how you said it, because yeah, you don't want to try and, you know, finance the whole thing where possible. You want to get other people's money, but you want to try and reduce obviously how much money, because then that's how much you have to pay back over the period of time with that agreement. But then I love the, you know, the seller agreement that you have as well, because then it's an incentive to the seller. It's like, well, you know, we're going to give you this much now, but then, you know, we hit the targets over the next few years, and then, you know, you can give you back that money over that time. And I like the bit, like you said, about if you put 40% down payment, that you only put 40% shares. And then that way in that agreement, you can say after the year, after we do these payments, then, you know, the rest of the shares, you know, if it's 3 years, 20% each, you know, for the rest of the remaining each year. Can happen like that. And then it makes it very straightforward, and it keeps it all like that. So that's really awesome to to hear about how to make it really easy for everyone. So that's great.
And let's say you can find the right lender for you. You can find the three lenders. I told you before, you need to have three lenders before the deal hunting. Let's say it's difficult for you, but you have the family office and private equity firms that they also investing in your criteria. They are investing in transportation, let's say. So you go to them, you knock the door, or you send the pitch deck, and you introduce to them this business opportunity. And you can say to them, listen, I need 30% of the asking price as a down payment. If you give me that money, the 30% of the asking price, I can give you 40% shares. So they make a profit in the day one, you know? So having a family office network and private equity firms matching your investing criteria is key on this acquisition. You know? It's all about preparation, having the right lenders, having your deal team, and having your network with private equity and family office firms.
Yeah, definitely. No, thanks for clarifying that as well. Very important. I completely agree. And so have you bought businesses using this methodology?
Yeah, so I bought four companies, including a football club in Spain. So I bought a football club, not Barcelona, but a third division one in Spain. So yeah, it was amazing because I'm originally from Argentina, so I kind of like football. I know football a little bit. That helped me, you know, to be from Argentina because I have credibility when I'm talking about football. Even if I don't know nothing about football, people will think I know about football because Maradona and all these players. So they approached me via LinkedIn, you know, these people from Spain, and then they flew over to my office in the Gherkin in London. So they came to my office, and then I've been negotiating the terms on them, and then I took over a football club. This is what was a great deal. Of course, football clubs are not really profitable, you know. They are good for fans and, you know, good for being in the media, but not really profitable, but still it was a very good experience for me. And then I sold it to another investor from Saudi Arabia. And then I bought the biggest LED factory in Brazil, with plus 700 employees and 22 million euros on assets. So this was my biggest deal was this one in Brazil. How I did it from London. So what I did was what is called a holding subsidiary strategy. This is the one that I'm using at the moment. Not much people know about that. Is you set up the holding company in first world economies, and you have the subsidiary in the disadvantaged countries like Brazil. So what I did was I proposed to the seller to go global, to set up the office in London, in my office. So I create a holding company. I transfer the shares from the Brazilian company to London. So we are a subsidiary, global company. That means that your company valuation increase because you are a British company right now. And also it give you fast access to capital because London is the fastest city to raise capital. And the capital is quite cheap, 4.5% per year interest rate. So what we did was raise capital from London. We bring down the capital to Brazil as a working capital. And we did restructure this company for over 2 years. So this was my biggest deal, 22 million, euros assets, you know, a machinery and all these employees. It was an amazing deal, lighting industry. And then we sold it to a supplier, you know, a Chinese supplier. And yes, yeah, it was an amazing one. So yeah, this was my last one. And the one I have currently is TaskU. It's called, it's a virtual staffing company, virtual staff like freelancers agency. So we have 22 employees, 23 employees. And today I got a new employee from Latin America. So I recruiting people in Latin America and I outsourcing to the US and the UK. They are virtual assistant, mainly digital marketing tasks, you know, everything online tasks. So currently I have this freelancing agency and also I'm doing mentoring on the side, you know, in my free time. So I'm enjoying the journey. So yeah, this was my deals, you know, these deals, exciting, yeah. It's from LED factory to football club, nothing to do with the industry, you know, but that opportunity came to my way and I knew how to structure, you know, that deal, you know, opportunity. So I've been learning by myself, you know, I don't have an MBA, you know, I made big mistakes that cost me a lot of money. For example, the football club, I were I was paying the salary of the football players out of my pocket until I realized, no, I'm losing all my money I made from the LED factory, so it's better to sell it. So sometimes you lose a lot of money, you know, when you buy the wrong deal. So right now, I know that the due diligence is key on business. You don't want to buy a problem and you don't want to buy a job. So it's better to have the right people, you know, the right accountant, the right lawyer to fully analyze all the points for the business.
Yeah. Yeah, that's awesome. And I think, yeah, the biggest lessons are learned in experience. And, you know, you can obviously learn, you know, skills and things, or whether it's an MBA, whether it's from other people that have already learned it, you know, through other trainings and courses and stuff. You know, everyone goes on their different paths. But I think, you know, the experience of doing stuff is big. And for you to actually buy that, like, I love football or soccer, as we call it in Australia, myself, and follow a lot of it as well. So definitely, you know, having bought a club, you know, even if though you've sold it now, you could say you've owned a football club. So that's awesome for people.
It's in Wikipedia. It's, you know, it's on the news. You know, I bought the football club and it's a good experience. Yeah, it's good to have under your belt a football club. Yeah,
exactly. So even though you learned some lessons, obviously, from it, like, you know, obviously you were losing money and stuff from it, but you take the credibility and you take the lessons to make sure you don't make those mistakes later. And then obviously the big deal that you did, that sounds really awesome. And I like, you know, how you structure things with companies and stuff is important as well for, you know, for asset protection and, you know, to increase your valuations and things like that. So that's, it's really interesting to do that. And your last business with, you know, the freelancers, like you said, and virtual sort of people is really needed. Like, obviously in these times where we're not allowed to go out, you know, a lot and everything, and people are working a lot from home, it's more needed. And I think, it's more normal now. So there's going to be more
remote work. Yeah. Remote work is the new normal. Yeah.
Yeah, definitely. And you know, but it's awesome because it not only does it force you to do it, but it sort of makes you think on a global level now. Cause you're like, you know, before you used to maybe do meetings in your country and things like that. And yes, you would do global stuff, but you wouldn't potentially focus on it as much because, you know, you would be doing local things. Now it's like, I'm stuck here. I've got to see other options of who I can work with. So I think it's actually created a lot of opportunity for us to think bigger in what we do, which is really awesome and connect with a lot of other people. So they're really awesome, different diverse businesses. And it's great to hear that you've got that experience there. On the end of the process now, when selling a business, what key areas should we focus on to ensure, you know, we get the highest value for it?
Yeah, so to have the highest value when you're selling is you need to reduce debt as much as you can, you know, renegotiate the debts with suppliers, with all the debtors and with the banks. Having a clean company is very important when you're selling, you know, so I highly recommend to reduce debt or at least to renegotiate the debt with the bank suppliers, and also increasing the sales and also the brand awareness. I really believe that you need to invest money on on Google search, on search engine optimization. You need to, you know, your brand has to be very well known. So branding for me is very important, you know, rebranding. If the brand is not really good, you need to rebranding. So branding, reducing the debt, and also increasing the sales. These 3 points, you know, to get the most out of it are very important when you're selling a business. And also preparation. You want that when the buyer came to your way, they find a very tidy company, you know, with all the documents, all the contracts, very tidy company. So it's easy to do a due diligence. Sometimes when you go and do some due diligence, you know, some papers are on my wife's house, another papers are in another factory. It's a mess. So, you know, you need to make it easier for the buyer. If you want to sell, you need to have everything in place, all the contracts in Google Drive, let's say, very organized with softwares. And I really believe that you need to be a bit hiring some techie people to automate your business, you know, having all the software in place, easy to do a due diligence. So that way you're going to sell, you know, faster. And also some people is hiring, they like to hire brokers, you know, because they don't know how to sell a business by themselves. They are good at building, but not at selling. So a good option maybe is hiring a good brokerage firm, you know, that they can sell the business for you, or maybe try to reach out to your competitors. If you don't hate them, maybe you can reach them out and say, hey, do you want me, buy me out? I'm going to exit. So yeah, these ways is for selling, you know. Selling is when you see the big money, you know. Because when you buy a business, you need to do the repayments, investing in marketing. It's all investing, and you take a little bit of money out, you know. But you see the big money when you sell the business. So it's, for me, it's very important to prepare the business for sale. It can take you 6 months, 12 months, or 2 years. It depends the company size. So I recommend to have a tidy company. You know, if you want to sell it, it must be easy to do a due diligence, and also the branding. Branding must be good. Yeah.
Yeah. No, that's awesome. And yeah, I think with any business, like whether you're starting your own business or whether, you know, I think you should always have it to exit in mind. Like you're going to sell the business, even if it's, you know, you think you're never going to sell it, always do it, because it forces you, like you said, to get all your paperwork in order, get your systems in order, get, you know, all your processes and things like that. And I think a lot of people don't think like that. So then, you know, if you do the due diligence and there's things everywhere, it is a pain for the person that's buying, of course, but at the same time, you might be able to get a reduced cost for it because they don't have their stuff everywhere. If the due diligence takes longer, then you can go in and maybe improve it, you know, in terms of that way as well, as an opportunity. But yeah, I think branding is so important, you know, and, you know, there's obviously there's business branding and personal branding, but we're talking more business branding now. And yeah, you know, people, you need to differentiate yourself in that area. So that's really important. So yeah, I like those points, and you know, building it up and having everything ready is yeah, that's really awesome. So thanks for that. And yeah, I guess what advice would you give to people, you know, who want to expand their entrepreneurship focus through buying and selling businesses?
So it's a term called entrepreneurship through acquisition. You know, it's very trendy right now. I recommend to buy some book from some Harvard professors. They are writing a lot about entrepreneurship through acquisitions. So of course, as I said early before that, you need to be, you know, prepared, because the entrepreneurs are a bit impulsive. You know, they are creative, they're impulsive, they want to go and get it, you know, they are hungry, they want to, you know, they want to be creative. So for that, you need somebody. If you're a very entrepreneur, I highly suggest you to associate with a technical person, you know, which is more calm down and is more rational, and, you know, so find the right partner for this deal making journey, because it's very lonely, you know. It's lonely if you want to buy a business by yourself, you know, doing everything by yourself is very lonely. It's better to have the right mentor, the right team, the right partner for that. And also, you know, keep buying books from about negotiation. You know, Harvard is very important. Harvard University, they have a great negotiation, you know, books and ebooks that you can buy. And also they are talking about the entrepreneurship through acquisition, you know, how to become a CEO by 27-year-old, you know. So they have a formula, you know, to help you to set up your search fund, or to help you to set up your own company, how to take over companies using the alternative finance market. So I try to learn from the best, you know. I think, you know, Harvard University, they are great people. They take things very seriously. Of course, they are very academic people. They are not from real world. They are not from the streets. They are very academic, but you can use the academic world and matching with the real life experience and get a great result. You know, it's a mix of skills that you need to get. So I recommend people to study, you know, from MBAs, of course. Even if I didn't study MBAs, I recommend people to study MBAs and to do negotiation courses. Because on business acquisition, for me, negotiation is the must to get the skill, you know. Negotiation, you all the time negotiating with the seller, you know, the asking price with the broker, you negotiating the commission, with the lender also, you negotiating the terms. All the time you're negotiating. So negotiation is key, you know, on this deal journey. So I recommend getting a few books from negotiation.
Yeah, awesome. Now that's great. And yeah, Harvard's obviously well respected and documented, and I've probably got to look into a little bit more myself into that. So I'll definitely do that.
It's a book called Guide to Buy a Business. It's a book called Guide to Buy a Business, a small business. So you can buy this book for $20, and it's very, very helpful. You know, these people is doing a great job, because it's not much. I've been checking all the programs, you know, all the programs from the best universities in the world. If they have something like that what I'm teaching, you know, like the entire process before you buy a business, during due diligence, and after, it's a complete, you know, it's a complete process that I couldn't find, you know, an university that is teaching the entire process. They teach you one part, management only, or they teach you marketing, or they teach you how to sell the business like a broker, but not the entire one, you know, having a strategy, the branding, like all together. And I think, of course, you learn the complete process just by doing, you know, learning by doing. Yeah, definitely.
Yeah. Yeah, definitely. And like you said, I think there's a lot of value that you can get from them. I think we all need to, you know, learn new things, and whether that's from, you know, university degrees or short courses or books, or, you know, from that is, it helps with the own experience. But like you said, they can be very specific. Like, I just completed my MBA, so I do have a lot of the business knowledge there that does help me a lot in business. But you know, you sort of take the best bits from that, like you've said, you know, from the uni, but then you also, when you couple that with your experience and what you've actually done, then it becomes very powerful. Because yeah, the universities are not necessarily set up there for you for the real world, but they give you key fundamental understandings of processes. And like you said, negotiation, you know, and the sales process is like the biggest skill, the most, you know, important skill to learn. Because if you can't do that, then you know, you can't get business, and you may get a bad deal. You might not get what you want because you don't know how to negotiate and leverage, you know, depending on your position on what you're doing there. So that's really awesome. Really great points there on that. So thanks for that. And I guess, so what was your biggest failure and how did you overcome it?
Yes. So biggest failure. Well, you know, when I'd say that what's changing the country I'm originally from. You know, when you move from your country to another country to have kind of a better life, you know, it's a bit. It was a business experience. It was a life experience for me. You know, changing my everything you have, you know, for a better and a safer life in the UK, in London, I believe was the biggest challenge. And also, not failure, but you know, you feel a bit, you know, down sometimes the first year when, you know, you're trying to relax. And also, yeah, in terms of business, I think the football club was my biggest failure, because I bought it. I was very excited, but I think I bought the wrong deal. Wasn't profitable at all. I was putting money out of my pocket to pay player salary for 6 months, and you know, the sponsors, and trying to fight to get the sponsors. And I don't really know about much football. I know about, you know, business a little bit, but not much about football. So it was a big failure. Not failure. I still feel good. You know, I try to think positively, even about because I believe failures are good. You know, so I keep getting failures, and it's gonna get you more knowledgeable. You know, so this was a big failure buying this football club, but still it's good to have under your belt. You know, a football club and. Was a good experience. I would never buy a football club again, except this Barcelona, something profitable. You know? But yeah, I think the biggest one was what is one. I'm buying the football club, even if it was fun. But yeah, not really. Yeah, this is yeah. I don't take. You know, I'm very positive. So failure for me is positive. I don't know how to explain. You know, it's not failure. You need to keep moving on. You know. No time. That deal's coming to your way all the time. You don't need to stop in life and crying about your failures. So failures are good for learning, and it's the only way I believe you learn is by failures. You know? Yeah. By failing until you get success. You know? It's the only way.
Yeah, no, that's awesome. That's a great mindset to have, and I'm very similar. You know, having that positive mindset. Failures really. You just found out how to not do something, you know? So it's like, okay, how do you get that solution mind and entrepreneur mind and saying, okay, how do I change things? Can I do it myself, or potentially do I get a coach or a mentor, you know, that can help me, you know, with their experience to help me get through that challenge if that's the case as well. So depending on what the challenge is and the failure.
Reinventing, also reinventing yourself. If you fail with something, something is telling you this is not your right path. You should, you know, take another path or reinvent yourself. For example, when I started with this coaching business, I say, what is coaching? What is all this all about? Who need a coach? Who need a mentor? So I start to say, I'm not going to be a mentor. I'm not going to do videos on camera. So I was a bit, you know, shy with all these videos. But then I realized that it's a great way to increase your network. And also it's a great way to exposure yourself and to network globally, you know, because I have a client from, you know, most of the countries, you know, I have clients, you know, Canada, Australia. So it's very, it was great to meet all these people online. And if I didn't start coaching, I never met them, you know, in my life. So it's a good way for networking and for challenging yourself that and prove that you can do something good with people. Because if I help you to buy a business, you know, with no money down, always you need money. Doesn't mean it's going to be your own money. But if I help you to buy a business in Australia for $10 million, you're going to be forever grateful for with myself. You know, so Sebastian helped me to buy my first business, and then I'm going to buy my second one. So what I'm doing, I think, is positive. You know, I'm doing something good. You know, so you're going to feel better. You know, feel good doing something good. You know? Yeah, it's not just giving, you know, motivational speech. You know, I am actually getting bothered with people as an active mentor, you know. I'm trying to help people to actually buy a deal. So.
Yeah, no, I love it. That's really awesome points. And I completely agree that, yeah, it's so fundamental on both sides, being coached and mentored, but actually being the coach and mentor like us, you know, and helping others with our experience. And you get a lot of joy from that when you see them get the results, you know, in that way. And they're really grateful. So, yeah, thanks for that. So what is your biggest strength, would you say?
Strength, yeah. So some people say, you, Sebastian, you pretending your English is not good, but you are a very good seller, you know. So I think selling and negotiating, I think, are a good strength for me, you know. I also I've been studying a lot of negotiation courses. I went to Harvard School, you know, 2 years in a row to study negotiation only, and then I've been reading books, but it's all about practicing, you know. I'm a great believer of learning by doing. So I think negotiation can be one of them, you know. I don't know. The only one who I cannot negotiate is my girlfriend. But with the rest, I'm doing very well. I don't negotiate with my girlfriend. I just say yes. At home, I just say yes to everything. And then I negotiate outside. So I think negotiation and sales are my strengths, and also I feel like it's a good skill to have it, because you all the time are selling, you know, you all the time are making offers, and you all the time are negotiating. So you get what you negotiate, you don't get what you deserve, people say, you know. So I believe that I'm good at selling. I think so. Yeah, selling.
Yeah. No. That's awesome. And I completely agree that, you know, sales negotiation is the most important skill and one of my biggest strengths in the world. And yeah, you get what you get, and you know, you negotiate the rest. That you don't get a deal that just pops onto your lap and it's just like an amazing deal. You got to work for that, right? You got to go back and forth and things like that. That's life. And you know, and even if you take that outside of, you know, that specific buying and selling businesses, everything is sort of sales and negotiation these days, right? Like you know, all right, we'll talk about your partner in a minute, but in terms of, you know, let's just say if you have someone that has kids, right, you know, your kids are trying to negotiate to you to get them to buy them an ice cream, right? Or you need to negotiate your kids about when they're going to go to bed, you know, on time. So like, there's so many things in life that uses that. And, you know, from simple senses, obviously it gets a bit more in depth when you talk about it in a business. But yeah, with a partner, it's interesting. It's, I wouldn't necessarily call it negotiating, but it's about, keeping everything happy and making sure that there's maybe a bit of compromise there. It's all good at home. So that's always an interesting one with partners.
I know.
Stuff,
with your couple, you know, you negotiate, and you, when you date somebody, you also selling yourself, you know. If you stay with me, you're going to get that. You're going to, you know, this is why I'm good. It's not rational, but you're selling yourself, you know, when you're dating somebody, when you're selling a business, when you're buying a business, when you go, I think it's a human thing, you know, negotiate. So it's a human interaction. I see negotiation is a human interaction. So you are all the time trying to negotiate, even if you are not aware. I think we negotiate and we sell in all the time. So yeah, it's a good topic. I love this topic. Yeah. Love the topic.
Yeah, definitely. So, great points. So finally, you know, what has been key to your business growth success?
Yeah, key is knowing what you want to achieve, you know, have a clear understanding what you want to achieve. Okay, it's not all about money. It's all about also impacting people, you know, changing people's life, and say, okay, how can I make money also by helping others? How can I create something meaningful? that it's not all about money, you know, because I'm at the beginning, when you know, when you are younger, you only care about money, selling my business, I want to get my first million. And once you get your first million, you say, okay, what is next? You know, and then, so I've been, you know, making some money with my business acquisition. I've been traveling around the world. I travel in plus, you know, 85 countries. I'm crazy about traveling. Right now, I feel very sad with this coronavirus situation. But I love traveling. So I say, how can I do a business that mix traveling or global businesses and also working remotely from your computer? So the virtual staffing company I have, you know, the agency, freelancers agency, I can manage it remotely. And it's, I'm helping people from disadvantaged countries to get a real job. And I helping companies from Australia, Canada, or the US to scale their business with cheap labor. So I'm in the middle, you know, connecting first world economies with disadvantaged countries. So I help people to get a real job, you know, from Latin American countries. I'm also with this coaching stuff for the last 3 years. It's a very, very meaningful business for me. It helped a lot of people to close a deal, to families, to have their own business, to be able to send their children to good schools, to have good cash flow. So it also allowed me to travel more, because sometimes I get too involved with the mentees and I want to travel to their countries to close the deal for them. Like, let's close this deal, let's negotiate. So I jump in a conference and I want to be there for the closing. I want to be there for celebrating the deal acquisition. So in some cases I flew to, you know, for example, I flew to Vancouver, Canada to close a deal. I flew to California to close another deal, you know, to Brazil, to different countries, you know, to Spain. I like to get involved, like, you know, like I'm a partner, because I realize people get results when you are, when I get involved like an active partner and I fully committed with people. I believe this is a real coaching or real mentoring is when you get really into it, you know?
Yeah, that's awesome. And, you know, very valuable for somebody to have somebody like you that's so passionate and really want to help them in these days. Cause, you know, that's not really offered a lot, you know, in people that really want to get people over the line. So that's really awesome. Thank you very much for your time today, Sebastian. I'm sure many people have greatly benefited from your valuable wisdom. So how can people find you and get in contact with you?
Yes, so first, I want to say thank you. I really enjoyed this. I didn't know what to expect with this, you know, this podcast, this interview. And then, yes, I'm really enjoying, you know, I don't want to this end. It's just, but we need to end in some point, you know. I really enjoying. I think it is a great idea to have your own, you know, podcast like you're doing, and you encouraging people, you know, with the people you interview. It's going to be a snowball, you know, you're going to get a lot of success with this venture. So, you know, every start is difficult. So thank you very much for this opportunity to tell people more about business acquisition and also to get to know you better through this conversation. People can reach me out through LinkedIn or Instagram. I'm quite active, so they can put my name and last name. It's difficult to pronounce Amieva, my last name, but they can find me on LinkedIn or Instagram, or they can join my Facebook group. I have a Facebook group talking about business acquisition, which is called Buying Businesses for a Living. So the Facebook group is the great way to learn. I put in a lot of content weekly, you know, interviewing people in this niche, so they can learn a lot of free tips from this Facebook group, Buying Businesses for a Living. Yeah,
awesome. Thanks so much for the feedback and letting everybody know how, you know, they can get in contact with you. So thank you everyone for watching and listening to this show where we talk about everything on business growth. You can find me on Facebook, LinkedIn, and Instagram as Ethan Cassiotis, or visit my website, ethancassiotis.com. I completely agree with you, or do I? The only way you will know is if you tune in next time. So until next time, remember that our business grows when we learn skills and take action using them in spite of fear. Have a great day.